In this segment, you will learn how cortisol, a steroid hormone, is synthesized and secreted, and how that synthesis and secretion of cortisol can be turned off. You will also learn the various functions for cortisol. To begin, it's very important that you understand what causes the synthesis and secretion for cortisol. Synthesis and secretion may be stimulated by prolonged fasting, by prolonged exercise, by stress, hence the reason cortisol is often called the stress hormone, and lastly, circadian rhythm. So we tend to synthesize and secrete cortisol during the day, and we do not secrete cortisol at night. So the levels of cortisol will vary depending upon the circadian rhythm. So to begin the cortisol feedback loop, we will begin with the hypothalamus. So the hypothalamus is a region of the brain. It's near the center. Inside of the hypothalamus, we have some cells that are called neurosecretory cells. These neurosecretory cells, or neurosecretory neurons, to be more specific, will synthesize and secrete various hormones. In this case, the neurosecretory neurons will synthesize and secrete a hormone called corticotropin-releasing hormone, known as CRH. The hypothalamus is the only organ that will synthesize and secrete releasing hormones. So anytime you hear about a releasing hormone, you can automatically assume it was synthesized and secreted by the hypothalamus. Okay, so when the neurosecretory neurons synthesize and secrete corticotropin-releasing hormone, it travels down the axon of that neuron and into the axon terminal. So once CRH reaches the axon terminal, it is secreted. When CRH is secreted, it will move into what's called the hypophyseal portal system. This is a link or a bridge between the hypothalamus and the anterior pituitary. Once CRH arrives at the anterior pituitary, corticotropin-releasing hormone will bind to receptors on the endocrine cells. This will stimulate the anterior pituitary to synthesize and secrete another hormone called ACTH. ACTH stands for adrenocorticotropic hormone. ACTH then will enter into the systemic circulation, so now it can travel through the body. ACTH will specifically target the adrenal glands. The adrenal glands sit on top of the kidneys. So here you can see the kidneys, and the kidneys have a hat. The hat is called the adrenal gland. To be more specific in terms of the adrenal glands have two regions. The center of the adrenal gland is called the medulla. That's the most interior region of the adrenal gland. The outermost part is called the adrenal cortex. This adrenal cortex consists of three layers. The outermost layer is the zona glomerulosa. The middle layer is called the zona fasciculata. And the innermost layer of the cortex is called the zona reticularis. Now, adrenocorticotropic hormone, ACTH, when it targets the adrenal glands, it specifically will target the zona fasciculata. So ACTH binds to receptors on the zona fasciculata, and that stimulates the zona fasciculata to synthesize and secrete cortisol, your stress hormone. Now, the zona fasciculata mainly, its main role is to synthesize and secrete cortisol. Cortisol then can enter into circulation, and once it's in circulation, then it can have an effect on several different target tissues. Cortisol can target adipose tissue. Now, when we talk about adipose tissue with respect to cortisol, we'll be speaking about visceral adipose tissue, and peripheral, or what's called subcutaneous, adipose tissue. So in either situation here, when cortisol targets the visceral or the peripheral adipose tissue, lipolysis occurs. And so when lipolysis occurs, we know that we can take a triglyceride and we can break it down into our fatty acids and into glycerol. Glycerol then can be converted to glucose in the liver. And when we do that, that will increase glucose levels in the plasma. Fatty acids can enter into circulation, so you can increase the amount of fatty acids in the plasma. But also, fatty acids can go into the liver, and they can be converted to acetyl-CoA. They can then be converted to ketone bodies via a process called ketogenesis. And when those ketone bodies get produced via ketogenesis, they enter into the bloodstream. So the level of ketone bodies can increase in the plasma. Cortisol will also target skeletal muscle. And when it targets skeletal muscle, that will cause proteolysis. In proteolysis, you know, the product are amino acids. So those amino acids can go into circulation, so we can increase the concentration of amino acids in the plasma. But those amino acids can also go into the liver. And when they go into the liver, they can be converted to pyruvic acid and then into glucose, which will also increase your glucose plasma concentration. So now in the bloodstream, as a result of cortisol release, we have an increased plasma glucose concentration, increased amino acid concentration, increased ketone bodies, and increased fatty acids. We can take all of these into our visceral adipose, and we can store all of these as fat, as triglycerides. So if we store them as fat, we're preparing the body for another stressful event. This demonstrates the normal function for cortisol. Let's go ahead and move on to the next page, where we talk about situations where you have a prolonged stressful situation, so you have prolonged cortisol release. Chronic stress is bad. Some stress is okay. Too much stress is a bad thing, and we call that negative stress. So let's take a look at what happens under those conditions. To begin, we have the visceral fat here, which is the fat that lines around the internal organs. And then here's the subcutaneous fat, and that's your peripheral fat, or part of it anyway. We're only focusing on the stomach here. And so under conditions where you have chronic stress and you continue to release glucose into the bloodstream, fatty acids into the bloodstream, amino acids into the bloodstream, you will store those as fat, and you store them as visceral fat. So people that are under chronic stress and negative stress tend to have belly fat. Cortisol, or negative stress, or chronic cortisol release, can also have negative effects on the brain. Let's look at the three negative effects that can occur on the brain. There are various regions in the brain, and one of those regions is called the hippocampus. Chronic stress or chronic cortisol release will atrophy the hippocampus. In other words, it starts to break down or destroy itself. The hippocampus's normal function is to convert short-term memory into long-term memory. So if your hippocampus atrophies, meaning your cells are dying in the hippocampus, you have an inability to convert short-term memory into long-term memory. In essence, you have memory loss. Now, chronic cortisol release can also damage the prefrontal cortex. The prefrontal cortex is very important. It enables us to concentrate, for example, enables us to make decisions. And so if we damage the prefrontal cortex due to chronic cortisol release, this can lead to an inability to concentrate, and it can also lead to depression. Chronic cortisol release can also cause another region of the brain called the amygdala And the amygdala is actually important in recognizing fear. And so recent studies have suggested that chronic cortisol release can cause the amygdala to generate anxiety and depression. So people that tend to be under a lot of stress have anxiety problems and as well as depression, and that may be because the amygdala is generating that. Now, cortisol, chronic cortisol release, can also atrophy the thymus. The thymus is very important because the thymus helps with your immune responses. So if cells of the thymus are being destroyed, like the cells of the hippocampus were, the thymus then can no longer function in terms of the immune system. So you atrophy the thymus, you suppress the immune response. Once we have cortisol synthesized and secreted, we need to turn it off. So once we have cortisol in the systemic circulation, cortisol can have an inhibitory effect on the endocrine cells of the anterior pituitary. They can inhibit the responsiveness of those endocrine cells to CRH. If we inhibit the responsiveness of the endocrine cells to CRH, the endocrine cells are less likely to synthesize and secrete ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone. Cortisol, when it's in circulation, will also come up and have an inhibitory effect on the hypothalamus. And so when it acts on the hypothalamus, it inhibits the synthesis and secretion of CRH. So if the hypothalamus does not synthesize and secrete corticotropin-releasing hormone, there's no signal to the endocrine cells of the anterior pituitary to synthesize and secrete ACTH. Therefore, if there's no ACTH binding to receptors on the zona fasciculata, the zona fasciculata will not synthesize and secrete cortisol, and hence we have turned off cortisol secretion.